Belinda presents this unabridged recording of the Queen, her lover, and the most notorious spy in history, written by Roland Perry and read by Deidre Rubenstein and David Tredinnick. The dedication reads, Dr. Leon Levin, Professor Ed Byrne, Professor James Saros, and Dr. Anne Saros for their support.
Victoria was lame and unable to stand upright, yet bent on marrying nobody but Lord Elphinstone. Robert Browning. Preface. In 1993 and 1996, when I was interviewing ex-KGB agents on camera in Russia, it was revealed that Anthony Blunt, a British double agent working for the former Soviet Union, had microfilmed a cache of royal correspondence and sent it all to KGB headquarters. At the time, I was researching two books, The Fifth Man, about Victor Rothschild, a member of the infamous Cambridge spy ring that had included Blunt, and Last of the Cold War Spies, about Michael Whitney Strait, the American member of the ring. I assumed that the important royal letters concerned the Duke of Windsor and his correspondence with Hitler and the Nazis. Two of the ex-KGB master spies, Yuri Ivanovich Modin and Vladimir Barkovsky, emphasized that the royal letters were important. For one thing, the KGB could have used them to blackmail the royal family. For another, Blunt's passing them on to his Moscow masters meant he had something over his palace masters and his MI5 superiors. It was subtle and unspoken. At no point did Blunt ever threaten anybody, but all concerned in British intelligence and at the palace tiptoed around him for 30 years, from when MI5 first became suspicious of him in 1949 until his knighthood was taken from him in 1979. One element of the correspondence that the KGB master spies hinted about was Queen Victoria's disclosures to her daughter concerning a love affair she had had before she met Prince Albert. Research established this was the 13th Lord Elphinstone. I spent many months poring over the 309 massive files in his archive in the Asian section at the British Library in London. Library staff estimated that a full review of this archive would take 6 years. The files appeared to have been intermittently vetted or edited, the last review being in 1982. The problem with this filleting of letters is that events and other information overtake the files. New and related data over time gives more meaning to the original retained information. Coupled with speedy internet searches, cross-checking and access to other related files, for instance in India, where Elphinstone spent so much time, there is no hiding from or prevention of fresh perspectives and often insights and revelations. Short of destroying all the files, vetting can never avoid increased perception. While working on this story, I came across an Englishman claiming that he was a direct descendant of Queen Victoria and that she had had a bastard child while in seclusion at Ramsgate between September 1835 and February 1836. If true, the father of this mystery child, allegedly born in late October 1835, had to have been Elphinstone. I was sidetracked by this undertaking for over a year of exhaustive research, but there was no direct evidence of this illegitimate royal birth. I had DNA checks done on the Englishman making the claim, but the results showed no direct link to the royals or Elphinstone. After checking of files, births, deaths and marriages, wills in England and Scotland, and a myriad other documents over six generations, there was nothing definitive linking this claimant to either Victoria or Elphinstone. Not even the Mormons, who bought up church parish registers in the UK and elsewhere going back to that time, could assist. The more woman's motive for acquiring these records was to baptise everyone on the registers into their church to boost their claim to having huge numbers. There was a great deal of circumstantial evidence that a child, who had been adopted into an impoverished London servant family in 1836, did have enormous wealth, mainly property, settled upon him in most unusual circumstances in a long-running cover-up. This person died in 1919, aged 83. His son died in 1968. Post-1968, that property, worth about £3 billion, was fraudulently distributed after relatively small payments, worth just £3 million, were made to descendants of that original adopted child. These payments were enough to buy off or prevent anyone in the family investigating the fraud, except for the one individual, the Englishman to whom I was introduced. I may return to this story. A little distance and time will make it an enticing project. I am most grateful to Yuri Modin and the late Vladimir Barkovsky, both of whom were formerly Moscow controls running the British spies recruited mainly at Cambridge University, England, in the 1930s, 1940s and 1950s. I visited them in Moscow several times, and they were unfailing in their courtesy and assistance. They both indicated at the beginning of our conversations that they would not provide information that was not already known by Western intelligence. I was happy with this. It put me ahead of anyone else in the Western media, and the data collected allowed me to probe deeper. Several journalists, including Philip Knightley and the late John Costello, were helpful with information. Thanks also to those who offered comments and insights, including Dr. Leon Levin, Dr. Anne Saros, and Diana Georgiev. Jack Grossman, the documentary filmmaker who accompanied me to Russia, died in May 2013, but not before he read and offered advice on this book. His encouragement was always a mainstay and great support for me in my books on espionage agents, and also this current book. My thanks also to publisher Sue Hines at Allen & Unwin for her support on six books. A word on the style of the book. I call it non-fiction with occasional dramatisations and reconstructions. This is similar but not the same as a television or film script writer writing on a non-fiction subject and recreating some scenes based on correspondence of the participants, interviews and other sources. Such stories and reenactments are daily staple diet for television and film. The book writer can vary this film script writing approach to make an otherwise complex narrative more accessible, digestible, and comprehensible for the reader, while keeping the subject's integrity intact. The key is to do at least as much research as one would for an academic or non-fiction project. This approach leads to the writer facilitating comprehension of a subject, rather than simply regurgitating dry facts. I believe in the axiom that there are no dull topics, only dull writers. Professor Roland Perry, OAM, Bachelor of Economics, Fellow of Monash University, Writer in Residence, Monash University, May 2014.
Chapter 1. A Princess in Peril. 16-year-old Princess Victoria was in a terrible state. Her mystery illness had lingered for several months by mid-October 1835, and her physician, Dr. James Clark, had been unable to give a convincing opinion in his consultations with her at the family's hideaway resort at Ramsgate on England's east coast. The 51-year-old Scot, who had qualified at the respected Aberdeen University, was not the finest diagnostician. He had spent most of his working career as a naval surgeon and rarely attended to women. He had joined the household of the widowed Duchess of Kent, Victoria's 49-year-old mother, in April 1835 at the direction of the Duchess's brother, Leopold, King of the Belgians. The young princess's illness had been this earnest doctor's first real challenge since attending to the Kents. He mulled over a variety of ailments. Clark had examined her in late August in her bedchamber, with her lady-in-waiting, Baroness Letson, present. He asked the princess to remove her clothes. She lay, grim-faced, on her back, naked but for underwear. Glancing over his spectacles at the princess, Clark mumbled in his broad brogue that her tummy seemed a bit bloated. He ran his fingers over her stomach and pressed here and there, causing Victoria to wince. Clark asked her about her complaint, that she was having a problem going to the lavatory. "That's the trouble," Victoria said in a frustrated tone. "I can't go at all, doctor." Clark motioned for Letson to help Victoria dress. "I believe you have constipation, pure and simple, my lady." "But you thought it was a bilious fever a month ago," Letson proffered. "You even thought I might have typhoid," Victoria said. "God knows you may have it still, my lady," Clark said, his authoritative manner intact. "But you are having trouble with constipation." Before the others could protest, he added, "You must have a daily dose of physic before breakfast. I will personally make up some for you today." "Physic?" Victoria frowned. "It's a laxative," the doctor said. "You should be right in a week or so." Clark departed. Victoria said to Letson, "I shall never let a doctor examine my body again." When Victoria collapsed soon afterwards, Clark was in London. Letson begged the Duchess and the controller of the Kent household, 49-year-old John Conroy, to bring Clark back to Ramsgate urgently. "No, that would be ridiculous," the Duchess of Kent had scoffed. "Such a summons would cause an unnecessary noise in London." She was thinking of her brother-in-law, King William IV, himself ailing. He had often voiced his disapproval of the way Victoria was being treated by her mother and tall, handsome, and stern Conroy. The latter had emerged as the main culprit in the eyes of King William and those close to unfolding events. Conroy, formerly an Irish officer in the British Army, was a philanderer and seducer who seemed to have a peculiar grip on the Duchess of Kent. He acted as if he were a strict father to Victoria. Over time, especially by late 1835, people whispered about his proximity to both women. Rumours circulated. Was he Victoria's father? The Duchess's husband, the Duke of Kent, was believed to have been impotent late in his life. Was it possible that in 1819 the fiercely ambitious Conroy and the poor and avaricious Duchess had coupled secretly to produce a child who would be claimed as the Duke's? The child would be in line for the throne, and there would be an increased annuity from the privy purse for them. If true, it would mean that Victoria was a bastard, ineligible to become queen. The speculation was understandable, yet without the science to decide paternity, it was little more than court tittle-tattle. More likely, the stout, doubt-riddled, and indecisive Duchess simply needed a strong man like Conroy to run her royal household, and he used his innate political skills to manipulate her. King William had been irritated all through 1835 by the way Conroy and the Duchess had paraded the princess up and down the country. They stayed with aristocrats and opened everything from hospitals and parks to porcelain works and flower shows. Conroy insisted that a royal salute be fired whenever they passed by, an honour normally reserved for the monarch. King William had considered this the height of presumption. He was the reigning monarch.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.